It is my great pleasure to participate and talk again this year in the 2021 Perfusion Conference. And I'm really touched this year for this invitation because this Perfusion Conference really this year dedicates to honor our women leading with the heart. Last year I was really very privileged to also participate and honor Terry Crane, as well as a perfusion school at the Texas Heart Institute. So the talk this year is for strategies for brain protection during proximal aortic surgery, as well as visceral protection during the thoracoabdominal aortic surgery. And I hope that you'll be able to find this educational as well as very helpful into your everyday practice. This is my disclosures. So starting with the renal and visceral protection after thoracoabdominal aortic surgery. Thoracoabdominal aortic surgery has significant perioperative mortality and morbidity. And this mortality and morbidity is large due to the aortic ischemia distal to the aortic cross clamp. And this ischemia may manifest as complications of the kidneys as well as the viscera. And the kidney dysfunction, as you can see here, can actually range from 12 to 50%, with up to 17% of patients needed hemodialysis, which actually may decrease the long-term survival. Mesenteric ischemia, even though it's not common, the mortality, if it happens, the mortality can be quite significant, up to 60%. These are the various surgical techniques and adjuncts during the thoracoabdominal aortic aneurysm repair, via which really we protect the renal and the visceral hemodialysis vessels, as well as the organs, as well as the spinal cord. So the first hemodialysis technique and adjunct is the cardiopulmonary bypass with hypothermia. This is a mechanically oxygenated hemodialysis blood. We use this technique when we are not be able to apply safely a proximal aortic clamp. A long venous cannula is placed into the right atrium via the femoral hemorrhoid vein, and drainage is assisted via cannulation of the left atrium through the left inferior pulmonary vein. In addition, as an arterial cannula, we use a 20 or a 22 French straight cannula, which is placed in the femoral hemorrhoid vein. And then, of course, we cool down to a deep hemorrhoid hypothermia, 18 or 20 hemorrhoid degrees. As I mentioned, this technique is used only, at least in our practice, when we're not be able to proximally place an aortic hemorrhoid clamp. Most of the time, the technique that we use is left heart hemorrhoid bypass. Via the left heart bypass, we provide hyzothermic, self-oxygenated blood into the distal aorta, while the proximal anastomosis, as we see here, is being performed. And usually the left heart bypass is applied to extend 1 and 2 hemorrhoid repairs, occasionally into extend hemorrhoid 3 repairs. And this is a closed circuit in centrifugal pump technology. And this bypass, as we see the circuit, is from the left atrium into the distal descending thoracic aorta to provide blood into the viscerals as well as the kidneys during the proximal hemorrhoid anastomosis. And this is another way that we protect the kidneys and the viscera. And we can see here the cannula in the inferior pulmonary vein on the top right-hand side image, and then the arterial cannula in the distal descending thoracic aorta. So during the proximal anastomosis, the left heart bypass is on, and provides the blood into the visceral, as we said, into the kidneys, into the distal ephmoid aorta. And then when the proximal anastomosis is completed, the left heart bypass is off. At that point, the protection to the kidneys and to the visceral is as follows. We use a standalone roller head pump where we provide called crystalloid solution into the left renal and to the right renal, as we actually see in this ephmoid picture. This is the this cold perfusion is actually especially beneficial in patients with preoperative renal insufficiency. Different perfusate solutions used and in other practices is blood, saline, Ringer's lactate or Ringer's acetate, as well as custodial solution. In our own practice, we have used for many years the Ringer's lactate with mannitol and solumedrol, but over the last few years we have switched into a custodial solution. Now the way that we infuse it is as an initial bolus, approximately 300 cc, and then we use it intermittently every 15 minutes until the arterial flow is established. And this is one of the ways to protect the kidneys. Now, with regards to the viscera, the way that the perfusion is established, this is via a Y connector into the left of the left heart bypass circuit. And this is what we do with the visceral perfusion is we mechanically perfuse the celiac and the superior mesenteric artery to minimize the total mesenteric as well as hepatic ischemic time. And we can see here the Y branch off of the rerouted left heart bypass circuit. And this is a continuous flow to for approximately 400 ml per minute. And again, we provide, with this way, we provide hyzothermic, self-oxygenated ephmoid blood. When we perfuse the visceral, this is usually in the more complicated ephmoid repairs, usually for the extent 2 repairs, and especially when we use a tetrafurcated multi-branch graft. Now, what we have found is, and the reason behind this visceral perfusion is to potentially reduction in the risk of the post-op coagulopathy and bacterial translocation from the bowel, and it is easy to perform and does not really add more risk into it. So another way to protect the kidneys and the visceral is by the way that we perform the anastomosis. We're using a ephmoid bypass graft, or sometimes also we place balloon expandable stents into the superior mesenteric artery or into the renal arteries, as well as the celiac ephmoid artery. And again, the way that we manage it can be with individual branch grafts, as we see in this ephmoid image, or actually as the anastomosis is performed as an island. With regards to the viscerals and the renals, the island usually contains the superior mesenteric artery, celiac artery, and right renal artery, with the left renal artery done as a separate anastomosis. So in summary, the way that we protect the kidneys as well as the mesentery, the visceral organs, is via left heart, is a combination of left heart bypass, cold renal perfusion, visceral perfusion, surgical management regarding the reattachment techniques, as well as an expeditious repair. And the most important is to have, of course, a great ephmoid team. Now, switching gears, how we protect the brain during ephmoid arch ephmoid surgery. Again, the primary goal here is to preserve the cerebral ephmoid function, and the brain, as we know, is extremely sensitive to ischemia. What we like to do is to suppress the cerebral metabolism with the use of the hypothermia, as well as to provide the metabolites by the means of the anterior, of the antegrade or retrograde cerebral perfusion. So the three main cerebral strategies, as you know, one is the deep hypothermia, and the other two is the antegrade cerebral perfusion with hypothermic circulatory arrest, or the retrograde cerebral perfusion with during the period of a hypothermic circulatory arrest. One of the things that you know very well is that there is debate regarding the optimum brain protection strategy during arch surgery. And as we have, see here is some of the groups in the country, especially the Yale group, is very a big advocate of the deep hypothermia. And in their hands, they found that up to 50 minutes of deep hypothermia can be considered safe. And we can see how the stroke is 1.3% with less than 50 minutes and goes up to 16 or and more percent when the circulatory arrest extends to more than 50 equity minutes. So this is why really for extensive arch reconstruction, adding antegrade or even retrograde cerebral perfusion, recommended. We can see here, this is the trends in the US as well as in Europe. This is a few years ago, but the trend actually remains quite similar. Most commonly what is used around in the various aortic equity centers is the antegrade cerebral perfusion during hypothermic circulatory equity arrest. The way in our own practice, we have traditionally used equity axillary, at least for the last equity more than 13 years that I'm at Baylor College of Medicine and the Texas Heart. And for the last more than decade, we switched to a nominate equity cannulation. And this is our own equity strategy. We published this a few years ago in the Journal of Thoracic and Cardiovascular Equity Surgery. What is our cannulation strategy to provide the antegrade cerebral perfusion for brain equity protection during primary repairs of the aortic arch, but also during equity redo, equity repairs, and also in certain cases, emergency equity cases. And so how we start, proceed with the cannulation, axillary equity or equity anominate, via which we will be able to provide unilateral cerebral perfusion. The temperature decrease the temperature to approximately 24 degrees Celsius. This is considered to be moderate hypothermia. The range of the moderate is between 20 to 28 mm-hmm. degrees, and is our preference to go approximately 24 degrees equity Celsius, and then we start the period of the protected circulatory arrest with the antegrade cerebral perfusion. Now at that point, we add a second cannula into the left carotid equity artery in such a way that we provide bilateral antegrade cerebral perfusion during the arch reconstruction. The advantage of the antegrade, and still there is debate between unilateral versus bilateral cerebral perfusion for brain protection, is for the cases where the cirque of Willis is not complete. And when we finish the period of circulatory arrest and when we complete the distal anastomosis, then we go back into a full flow. One thing to mention is that during the circulatory arrest, usually the flows are down to 10 to 15 ml per kilo per minute. So in summary, the way that we protect the brain during the arch reconstruction is via metabolites with the antegrade provided with the antegrade cerebral perfusion, and in if possible we provide bilateral antegrade cerebral perfusion. We perfuse the brain at the rate of 8 to 10 or 8 to 12 ml per minute per kilo. The perfusion pressure, we try to maintain it 50 to 60 millimeter echmoti of mercury, and the temperature range between 23 to 28, with our preference to be close to 24 degrees echmoti Celsius. So you can see here that the protection of the brain during echmoti arch surgery is actually multiple echmoti modalities that we use to protect the brain, similar with the various modalities that we use to protect echmoti the visceral also during echmoti thoracoabdominal echmoti surgery. This is multiple papers that I was very honored to participate and author with your help, as well as with anesthesias echmoti helps over the last echmoti few years. Again, I would like to thank you for this tremendous echmoti opportunity. I would like to congratulate echmoti the organizers for this amazing echmoti conference and the amazing echmoti speakers. And it's really, I'm really touched by this invitation, especially because this year the conference is actually honoring women. Again, I would like to thank you. It's a great privilege to be here. And I would like also at the end of this talk to entertain any questions. Thank you so much.